Welcome and good morning to our fourth session on preparing for success from jail or prison. I'm glad to be back. I really want you guys to, I want to start off by saying how much I appreciate the engagement that we have been having these past few days. I really am enjoying an opportunity to share my thoughts on how I would respond to the questions that you're presenting. And I'll start off by just acknowledging my comments are not necessarily the answers. They're simply a response that I learned from leaders and that I try to share with you. But if at any time I'm saying something that doesn't make sense or that you don't agree with or doesn't coincide with what you're experiencing at the particular stage of your journey, then as I've said, you know, there's nothing we can't deliberate or debate and talk about. Hey, how do we use these concepts that we've been talking about to help us through really difficult times? And I know these are really difficult times. That's why today's lesson, the fourth lesson, is really about visualizing the future. Because for some of us, that future is a long ways away. And long is a relative term. For somebody who's there, like, you know, that's there for 4 or 5 or 6 months, that can seem like an eternity. And for some people that are there for multiple years, that can seem like an eternity. There's kind of an analogy that I've written about in some of the other books. One of them, I call it the U-shaped curve. And the U-shaped curve tells us that there's a couple of, if you can think of a U, right? If you think of a U, in fact, no, I don't want to share my screen because it's too hard to share the screen. If I think of a U, when you're coming into the jail system, you know, that's when your mind is still closest to, you know, everything you're missing in society. You're missing your family, you're missing your career, you're missing your reputation. And that's when it really hurts the most, at the very start of the journey. And yet, as you move down into the U, right, you come down towards the bottom, and it comes up before you start ascending the U. On this side of it, you have the prison or the jail culture, okay, where you kind of get used to it. You know, those of you guys who have been in there for a year or something like that already, you kind of get a feel for that. And I know I spoke with Hancock earlier, who's been in prison before. You know, he could probably attest to this as well, that once you get settled into the journey of the sentence, it's not as painful anymore because you kind of start getting used to that environment. And then when you start going home again, you start ascending the U, that anxiety comes back. And you start, you know, really missing it again. So this U-shaped curve, it's kind of the same whether you're serving 6 months, I think, or whether you're serving 10 years. It's hard in the beginning. It gets easier as you get to the center of the term, and then it gets hard again at the end. But for some people, I think it's really powerful and helpful to be able to recognize that there is a pathway. And there's always a pathway to what we're going to become. But if we don't have this really clear strategy, this three-legged stool that we've spoken about in previous lessons, where you've created a strategy, your own roadmap of what success means for you, and documented it, and you create this tools and tactics that will help you along the path, because you know what you need to get through. Yesterday, I heard from Jay, who said that he wanted to talk a little bit about how do I plant the seed. Well, we got to develop these tools and tactics, and we've got to maintain the hope and the discipline and the energy even during hard times. And then the third leg of our stool is we got to have these accountability metrics where we are in control of our life. That's when we stop feeling that sense of being a puppet, like I was speaking about with D'Angelo yesterday. If we want to stop the depression, if we want to stop the despondency, we've got to be able to see into the future. And so today's focus on this part of the course is called aspiration. And in your lesson plan, you're going to see how I speak about aspiration. I think I speak in the first guy I quote in there is Marcus Aurelius, who was a guy who really inspired me when I was going through jail, because he was a guy that lived centuries ago, and he was born into poverty as an orphan, and yet he rose to become one of the most powerful people in his era. One of the things that he did is exactly what we just spoke about, is he really documented what success would look like and what are the patterns that he can create. He wrote this book called Meditations. A lot of people in prison read it because it's helpful to us when we are living in struggle. And he didn't write that book for anybody else. He really wrote it for himself because he needed a roadmap that would help sustain his level of energy and discipline even when times were tough. But by reflecting and by thinking and by introspecting, he could always muster the strength, knowing that he was in charge of his own destiny, that he had to live in the world as it existed and not as he wanted it to be. So if you want a different world, if you want a different future, you've got to architect and engineer your pathway there. That's what this lesson is about. It's about seeing what am I going to become, and then how are my decisions today relating to what I want to become? In what ways am I making decisions today that are going to influence what I become next week, next month, next year, and in 10 years? Every person that I have met that succeeded, every person I read about that succeeded, except somebody maybe that won a lottery, you know, the people that really make something of their lives, they do it through a disciplined, deliberate course of action. And they're starting in struggle just like you're in struggle right now. You know, this is the first inning of your 9-inning game. Forget the past. You may have lost, you know, you may have made some decisions that put you in struggle in the past. But right now, we all can choose what we are going to do. And sometimes I get these emails, because these courses, you know, are not only in your jail, they're in prisons across the country. And I get letters from family members who are reaching out. And I got one yesterday that I wanted to share with you, because it's so sad for me to get this kind of information from somebody who is, you know, the wife is really suffering because of her husband. And this is what she writes. Hello and good day. My name is, let's just call her Linda. My husband has been in prison for the last 20 years. And now he is inside of a county jail facing new federal charges because of his decisions while he was in prison. And I'm just heartbroken about it. He has been reading your courses now, telling me that he wishes that he would have had access to this message at the start of the sentence, because then he wouldn't be going through these problems. That's, unfortunately, I hear that way too many times. And the reason I hear that, I really believe, is because our jails and our prisons really perpetuate this message that the best way to serve time is to forget about the world outside and to focus on our life in here. I'm so grateful to the administrators there at your jail that give me this opportunity to come in there and give you this message, because truthfully, it takes a lot of courage to bring somebody like me into the jail. And I always am grateful to administrators that allow me to go into the jail, because I mean, I was in there for 26 years. A lot of people look down on me. A lot of people want me, you know, to have nothing to do with law enforcement in this capacity. And really, it's because my commitment is to you guys wearing orange jumpsuits, guys wearing khakis, guys standing up for count. You guys are my brothers. And my job, my duty, my responsibility is try to show you this pathway. And so that's why we start every day by talking about what have we learned so far. We have learned that if we're living in struggle, if we don't want to have these problems in our future, we've got to follow this disciplined, deliberate plan, not for administrators, but for our family, for the people that love us, for the people that we love, for our communities, and most importantly, for us, because none of us wants to be living in an environment like we're going through right now. All of us want to reach our highest potential. And I really want to emphasize that I learned these lessons from leaders like I wrote about in the lesson plan today, Marcus Aurelius or Socrates or Nelson Mandela or Viktor Frankl or Bill Gates Steve Jobs and successful business leaders, or you know, presidents and governors and just anybody who achieved a higher level. They always give us a clue. And the clue that they give us is they never make decisions in the moment. They make decisions for what they want to become. When I was in there, I remember reading a book by a woman. Her name was Susie Welch. And some of you may have heard of her husband. His name was Jack Welch. And he was the famous CEO. He was the chairman of General Electric for a long time. And he used to say that she wrote in her book that every decision we make should be methodical. And she spoke about having this concept of 10, 10, 10 in your mind, saying when you're making a decision, and think about this, because this is really relates to what we're going to be talking about today. When you're making a decision, I want you to think about how your decision is going to influence your life in the next 10 minutes. And you know, and I know, that you can make decisions in jail that are going to have, that you're not even thinking about, but in 10 minutes, it's going to change your life. So when you're making a decision, think about that. How will this change my life in 10 minutes? How will it change my life in 10 months? And how will it change my life in 10 years? 10, 10, 10. That was her model. And she said, if you can think that way, that's when you start thinking like you're the CEO of your life. Like you're not waiting for somebody else to determine what's going to happen to you. Instead, you're thinking about, okay, I've got to make a decision right now. And there are people that are in jail, like the lady that just wrote me about her husband, who started off serving a sentence, but now he's back in the county jail facing new federal charges that could keep him in prison for the rest of his life. And he's wishing now I could think back. And I think all of us can look back and be thinking about what could I have done last year or 5 years ago or 10 years ago that would have me in a different position right now. I think all of us can do that. That's what really empowered me at the very start of my journey, as I started getting those lessons from leaders that I can't do anything about the past. And it's going to be really hard for me to think about what am I going to do when I get out of here? It's going to be, you know, so far away. You know, I mean, D'Angelo's kind of probably wrestling with these kinds of concepts right now. But I can tell you the world is changing. And the world, I don't have to tell you that you guys can see the news. Do you guys still have access to television right now, even during the pandemic? What's going on? So you see what's going on around the country. The world is changing. And a lot of people recognize that people in jail and people in prison are going to have a particularly hard time to come back to society because there's so much problems going on in the country right now. And people like us are like the, you know, we've already got so many things against us that we've got to live in this world as it exists. We've got to be thinking, what can we do? And so I really believe that it's so important for us to visualize that. Visualize that world we're going to. Visualize what do we have to do today so that we can sow seeds that will help us become something more tomorrow. And if you guys still have this opportunity in the afternoons to watch these videos that are part of this course, because ordinarily the course, like in most of the jails and the prisons where I teach, I don't get the opportunity to do this type of interactive work that we're doing together. And that's why I want to take advantage of the hot seat and bringing guys up and talking about it and teaching about it. And I am, you know, using your stories and your questions, blocking out your face, but I'm using these stories to say, I want to create a lesson out of this. But what you'll see is that all these videos I'm making, I'm going to bring them back into your jail. So they're going to go on that same platform. And as long as you guys have access to the videos in the afternoon, you're going to continue to get these videos where I am interviewing other people. And I want you guys to be a part of that because I think your stories are relevant. I think your life experiences are relevant. And I think that the more we understand what you're going through, and you know, the more we interact or talk about different strategies that we can pursue, the better off society becomes. That was my aspiration when I started on, in my prison sentence, and it's still what my aspiration is. Yesterday, after I finished interviewing, after we finished our course yesterday, I had to get off the call because I had another call with a business guy that I told, I reached out to him and I said, look, I'm creating these courses that I want to bring into jails and prison. And I asked him, would you allow me to interview you? And so this guy is an amazing guy who's big in the hip hop and sports world. And he's telling me, you're going to see it because I'm going to bring it in there. But there's a total of 11 videos because it was a long interview. And I've been breaking it up into a series of shorter clips so that I could create some takeaways for you as well. And one of the things that he told me is that he started in a time that is, he started his company, which is called Vlad TV. He started this company at a time that was very similar to what we have today. It was a time during the recession and he didn't have any money and it was something brand new, but he was really passionate about music and he was passionate about people that he wanted to hear their stories about how did they become active in music. But he didn't have any money. He just had this vision and this commitment. And he talks about how he visualized how he could build something new, even though the only tool he had was, you know, a camera. And I'm going to share his story with you because I think it's something that each of you could be thinking about what kind of career can you build if you want to come back and create your own job. If you come back to society and you know that the job market is very tough for people like us, formerly incarcerated people, and it's 100 times more tough today just because of the pandemic and because of the 60 or 40 million people that are unemployed, I know that I would have a really hard time getting a job in today's marketplace. But if you sow these seeds right now, you will feel as confident as I feel that you don't really need a job. You can reach out and have a different mindset and create your own job. And your job is like the most important part of your stability. It's what allows you to live. It is what allows you to provide for the people that you love. There's this theory that I write about. I don't remember which one of the chapters in this book. And many of you may know this psychologist who wrote this story called Maslow's Hierarchy of Needs. But if you don't, I'm going to just kind of help you understand it for those who aren't familiar with it. Maslow was a psychologist. He came from another, his parents were immigrants and he was Jewish. And so he struggled from a lot of the equivalent of racism. I think it's called xenophobia, but or anti-Semitism, where a lot of people didn't like him in his community just because he was Jewish. And so he didn't feel safe because he always felt as if he was picked on and he felt as if the world was attacking him. So he found his peace inside of libraries by learning. But he visualized that if he could learn more, he could figure out a way of how human behavior works, and he could figure out a way how to contribute to his community by helping more people understand. And he came up with this theory of human behavior that is called, now known as, Maslow's Hierarchy of Needs. And what he says is, if we don't have this feeling first of safety and stability and peace in our life, we can never advance to a higher level. The first thing we've got to do is get our basic needs resolved. Well, right now you're in an environment that you have your basic needs resolved. You're getting your food every day, your water every day. You've got clothes to wear and a place to sleep. Unfortunately, there's a lot of people in society that don't have that. And so as crazy as it sounds, they may have their liberty, but they don't know where they're going to sleep tonight. And so it's a big struggle for them. And a lot of people in jail and prison come out and they have that experience. Once you if you can solve that problem of getting your basic needs resolved, then you can solve the next problem of feeling safe and secure. And then you can solve the next problem of figuring out how to develop new concepts and a new mindset. And if you can solve that problem, then you can get to the next level where you're starting to think about the broader community and realizing your highest potential. But it's all a gradual shift. And for people like us, we've got to, if the more we know about that, the more we can architect our own strategy. And that's why I keep asking you guys, hey, let's discuss this together. Because this is how I did it. And it's how I'm still doing it right now. I know that I have a duty and a responsibility to show as many people in jail and prison the lessons that I learned from Malcolm X and Viktor Frankl and Nelson Mandela and so many other people who lived in difficult times, and they taught me how to adjust while I was climbing through that prison journey. And because of that, I had a different experience from a lot of the people that I'm reading about or that reach out to me when they're at the bottom, when their families are worried that they're going to get, you know, be in prison for the rest of their life. But even if you're facing the rest of your life in prison, you will see videos on this channel that I'm going to bring into there that are already on your feed of guys that started off with life sentences. They had no release dates. But because of their behavior in jail and prison, after 10, 12 years, one guy was after 10 years, he got a clemency petition granted and he got out. Another guy did 17 years. But he was facing life. Not that he wasn't facing, he was sentenced to life. And yet, because of his decisions inside, he was able to persuade people and build a support network that resulted eventually in his getting his sentence commuted, and he's now home. So I don't know where you are in your journey. I don't know anything more than what you guys share with me through our interactions together. But I have interviewed more than 1,000 people, and and that doesn't only include people who are serving long terms in prison and jail, but also people that have come home, and also judges, and also prosecutors, and also probation officers, and even some legislators. And from all of those interviews and all that concept, I feel as though I really have to share that with people when they're sitting in a seat like that today. So in today's session, and we're already at 23 minutes of this first segment where I like to open talking about what we're doing, I'm really going to ask you, continue to engage with me and continue to use this time where I can share with you what I've learned. I know that Jay and some of the other guys yesterday said that you'd come up today. I want to encourage you to do that, because that's one way that we can take your story and use your story and your questions to help more people understand how they can become more successful, even if they're in a jail, even if they're in a prison. And there's nothing you can't ask me about my journey at any time, as I've told you every time during this session. But this is really about you. It's not about me. I just want to respond and share what I learned. And so I will be asking you each step of the way, I'm going to try to relate your question to how we define success, the values by which we live, which is what we studied in the first day. I'm going to relate it back to the goals. What are the clear goals that you have set, and are they consistent with what you define success as? And then we're going to talk about what we discussed yesterday, which is, do you have the right commitment? Are you making 100% commitment to success? Not as I define it, but as you define it. And then today, we're going to be talking about, or tomorrow, I guess we'll cover more about what we did today. What does your future look like? How are your decisions and your strategy, how is that related to where you are at some point in the future? What your aspiration is, what you visualize. Because success is all about visualizing the best possible outcome, creating a plan, putting priorities in place, and then executing that plan every single day. And we draw our energy and our discipline from knowing that we're advancing the ball, even if we're climbing through jail or prison. And so that's kind of what I wanted to just open up with today. And now I'd like to open it up with, for some of the guys to hear what you're going through, even if it's responding to the questions that we had yesterday, or we can work through some of the questions that are part of the lesson plan. But we do need to have interaction in order for us to get the best experience from here. And we're recording all of this, so it'll be going back into the jail as well. So I'm going to stop this monologue right now and try to bring in the interactive portion with hopes that one of you guys are going to stand up.